Hi viewers, welcome to this video presentation. This is public lecture series meant for conversation around the law and around the justice system in many parts of Africa. But to begin with, we look at Kenya. I want to refer myself to a reality found among the Mijikenda community in the coastal part of Kenya. The Mijikenda is a large community. Miji means tribe and Kenda means nine. In this case, the nine tribes of the Mijikenda. Don't look at tribes from its derogative understanding as barbaric people, as in the middle-aged Europe, in which the German tribes were known to be barbaric. This is not what we are talking about. We are talking about ethnic groups with their defined cultural practices, customary practices, judicial practices, legal practices, but also political practices. The groups that are politically organized. The Mijikenda, also known in a derogative term as the Wanyika. The Nyika, as in Nyika Plateau in eastern part of Kenya, were known to be bushmen, hunters and gatherers. We no longer use the term Wanyika. What we use is Mijikenda. The Mijikenda is a Bantu community whose origin comes from the other Bantus during the Great Migration into different parts of Africa through Tanzania. And even in the present, there are some Mijikendas in Tanzania. The Mijikendas were confronted by the Gala, and the Gala in the fight pushed them back, and they found their refuge in the Kaya Forest. The Kaya Forest remains as a great heritage protected by UNESCO, but also a refuge of a people known as the Mijikenda and their beautiful and rich culture. But who are the Mijikenda? Who are these tribes we are talking about? We are talking about the Rabai, the Ribe, the Jibana. We are talking about the Kambe, the Kauma. We are talking about the larger Griama. We are talking about the larger Digo. And great and wonderful people, the Duruma. We are talking about the Chonyi. These people formulate into the Mijikenda. But what is so interesting in the Mijikenda, they have got a council of elders that is still in function and very active, known as the Kaya Elders. The Kaya Elders are anchored on the custody of their traditional system, whether in terms of the legislative authority or in terms of the judiciary authority, but also in terms of the executive authority. Little is known about the Kaya Council of Elders. Personally, I have witnessed some of the sittings and sessions of the Kaya Council whenever they gather. They gather in assembly to deal with their parliament, in which they review their rules, they revise their laws, as well as they see how to amend certain rules that may not be agreeably working today. But also they gather in another session, that is in the court session. In the court session, the council admits certain matters on merit for adjudication, but first for hearing, then adjudication and the determination. What is so interesting is that the Kaya Council of Elders works in collaboration with the local magistrate court. Some court matters are referred back to the Council of Elders for adjudication and its consideration. And some matters are referred by the council to the magistrate court for adjudication. They work in tandem with the local authority, even the police. But in this case, what is so peculiar among the Mijikenda is that they are still faithful to their traditional regime. This is the alternative justice system. It is defined under the provided for rule on the access to justice, but most particularly on the traditional dispute resolution mechanisms. And in that case, and this material matter, we see the traditional court, the African court, in its real sense. In this reality, adjudicating such matters, notwithstanding certain politics around the Council of Elders, the Kaya Council of Elders gather under their secretary. The secretary is also a symbol within their culture of a certain authority that is related to the divinity. So in this case, the entire legal system here is within a regime that is very traditional and is inclusive with their religion, with their customs, practices, beliefs, and also their traditions. One may rightly argue, saying that, how is this applicable in the modern system, in the world of formal education, in which most of the youth have attained certain formal education that is opposed to certain customary practices in the past? That kind of predicament is real and genuine. It is real and genuine simply because until we distinguish between what is of law and what is of other areas or non-legal areas, we are going always to be repeating similar mistake of the colonial regimes. The British administrators, by introducing the administrative authority as an appeal for the African court, was already a blunder instilled, in the sense that the African traditional legal and judicial systems are premised on a culture of a people. The people understand the language, they understand the meaning of their ideals, and also the meaning of justice. It is opposed to, let's say, for instance, French borrowed terminologies or English borrowed terminologies, or rather Arabic terminologies, but they tend to be inclining on justice system which they can understand and can speak to their culture at that particular time. We are not opposed to the reality that is dynamic and also the changing reality, but we are just acknowledging the fact on the ground. What is on the ground is known as the living customary laws, the practices of the people. How people adhere to those kind of practices is something that we cannot dispute. It is not under contestation when we see individuals going to pay dowry or to give dowry or to pursue the dowry institution and its rules for the benefit of their social structure and their culture. We are not disputing the practices that already the very practitioners believe in. This is the reason for which the Judicature Act, Chapter 8 in Kenya, under Section 3, still upholds the use of the African customary law by the Supreme Court, the Court of Appeal, the High Court, as well as all subordinate courts in civil matters, but as a guiding principle in matters in which both or one party is affected by such custom. It is a question of giving justice or doing justice to the people, to the parties, without prejudice. And we are hereby saying that the African judicial system must still be understood in its pure format. And that means we need to remove other understandings that may be criminal in nature, the politics around it, but also certain beliefs around it that may not help us to understand what is law and what is justice as opposed to other areas of social life. This is the reason for which I do believe that we are under urgency to see that traditional authority should be brought into the limelight by the legislature so that such authorities can speak to such judicial systems that are still in the traditions and practices of the people and are less known to the professional practice of law and practice of justice today. Thank you for watching. Peter here, University of Nairobi School of Law, Kisumu Campus. I expect to meet you again in the other public lecture series of this kind. Bye for now.